Welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera Blind. I'm the RPG chick. We've finally found Delny and Vrung, who are the ones who are kicking. Yeah, they still look like shadows over there. They're one of the ones kicking Qianne. Twice the trouble. Qianne, a refugee who lives in the Memorvere's courtyard, is being harassed by a pair of thugs. I offered to help her deal with the problem. Find the thugs who have been harassing Qianne. Two thugs are named Delny and Vrung, and they're hiding in the slum of Little Nihliesh. I should track them down and have a little talk with them. So I'm gonna do that now. Right frickin' now, man. Shadow guys. Mystery men. Hail, fool! And they are really shadows. The slim girl is almost a mirror of the boy who stands next to her. They could be twins or clones, so close is the resemblance. You can see that her features are sharp, though shadows flit and play too quickly across her face to be sure of anything else. She slumps almost imperceptibly inside her cloak of darkness. As you open your mouth, her excuse me. As you open your mouth, her companion interposes himself. One of their thoughts says, "Help!"
I'll remember that.
The sharp-faced young man, Vrung, reminds you of a great rodent, more prone to scampering and sidling than running or walking. Shadows play across his face, distorting his features, and you are unable to get a clear glimpse of his face. Even so, or perhaps especially because of it, he seems to bear a notable resemblance to the young woman standing next to him. Their face is shifting and changing in near perfect time. At your approach, he sniffles loudly and drools some phlegmy spit across your path. Ew. He wipes his mouth with the back of his hand, and though you can't see his face, his tone conveys the sneer clearly enough. "What do you want, Poppin' Jay?" His voice echoes eerily, a slight delay between the movement of his lips and the sound reaching your ears. He thinks, "I don't like the look of this one. Better get rid of her fast." "Who are you?" He draws himself up and seems to loom. "I am the shadows. I'm the terror in the night and creeping death. I'm the flash of the blade. I am Vrung." Okay, I see two metal references here. Creeping Death, Metallica. I'm Creeping Death, and Flash of the Blade, Metallica. Yeah, it might not be references, but still. Cool. He throws his arms wide dramatically. A moment later, his companion does as well, the asynchrony somewhat spoiling the effect. He hisses at her, and the looming presence fades. He thinks, "We are terror, Delny. Scare her away." "What are you doing here?" He looks at you, incredulous, his voice dripping with sarcasm. He replies, "We're enjoying the fresh air, taking in the ambience. We are living our lives to the fullest." He looks at the young woman next to him, and she begins to titter. He thinks, "Laugh, Delny. We're having a great time." "What can you tell me about this place?" "Small talk." "It's a parade every day. Don't let the looks fool you. Little Nihliesh is all about the laughter. Maybe you could let the fluid out of Gar-koto's tank. That's a prank that never gets old. Make sure you do it while the guards are watching." He thinks, "Ha! I wish she'd actually try it." "Who's the girl with you?" Perception check. For the briefest moment, you think you see the face of a victim in her shadows. She casts a despairing eye at you, and then the darkness fills her face with a sneer. Vrung says, "Her? She's no one. I am Vrung." "I asked who the girl with you is." "I said she's no one you need to be concerned about. She's my shadow and my hidden blade, and you should take care I don't stick you with her." "Why does the girl's face keep changing when you talk?" "Why do you keep asking about her? Delny is mine, and she will stay mine until I say otherwise. I am the one who's interesting. I am the one you should care about." "Wow." He thinks, "Why won't you let this go? This woman is pissing me off." Vrung's rage seems to have loosened his control over his companion, for you see a flash of blue skin beneath the shadows. Her mouth works frantically, as if she's trying to tell you something while her captor struggles with his fury. With an effort of visible will, Vrung brings himself and her back under control again. Are you the pair who have been harassing Qianne? He laughs at you. What, has she been complaining that we're too mean? Too scary? She can afford it, else we'd be visiting someone else more regularly. I'm not paying them money. The psychic bond you have on Delny. Remove it. He laughs, a shivering peal of mirthless joy that sounds like ice breaking and glass ringing. She is mine. She'll go on my word, not yours. He thinks, aw, a bleeding heart. Well, she can't do nothing about it. Okay, well, that is a double negative. I can't do nothing about it, so that means I can do something about it. I tell you again, remove the psychic bond you have on Delny. He laughs again, cold and mirthless. Alright, intimidation. Who's good with intimidation? I am... have one training level. Okay. I'll do it. What? Why do you hound me so? You want attention, don't you? If you don't let her go, I will teach you what suffering truly is. 85%. Success. The young man opens his mouth for a sarcastic comeback, but he realizes you might be serious. He holds up his hands to placate you. All right, one moment. He concentrates, or rather, doesn't concentrate, and the shadows flow away from his face and body. He's a much scrawnier person than you thought, almost gaunt, and he doesn't look at all dangerous or menacing. He thinks, I wonder how long this thug's gonna stick around the bloom. Maybe I can get her back someday.
Making a note.
Huh. He slinks toward the exit quickly and quietly, vanishing around the corner. But we didn't get to help Qianne with her thing. Unless maybe Delny can help with that. And I'm not a thug. I'm probably going through a maw soon, so you might not see me after a little bit. Delny drops to the ground as he vanishes, and her body begins to tremble and shake. She thinks, am I free? Oh gods, the pain. Make it stop. Try to help her remain calm with healing. Oh, 95. Critical success. Whoa. Stat pool spent on effort restored. Nice. Her eyes snap open in blind terror, seeking any refuge from the nightmares that seem to be replaying in her head. She sees you then, and she begins to relax immediately, her muscles unclenching one by one, and she eases out of her seizure. Thank the gods you're not Vrung, she whispers. The shadows have peeled away, drifting into the air like poisonous smoke and revealing Delny's true form. Her skin is an iridescent blue, and her hair is bright pink. She looks cool. He's really gone. I can't feel him in my mind. You did it. Fahat be praised, you did it. She shakes her head as if to clear it, and a small trickle of bluish blood runs from the corner of her mouth where she bit her tongue or lips. I don't know how to thank you. You must have questions.
I always have questions, baby.
You've had quite a time of it. How are you feeling? Even though I'm still in a bloom, even though we're still surrounded by all this, even though I need to make amends to everyone I robbed and bullied with Vrung, I feel hopeful. It feels like a new beginning, like the night has been peeled away and discarded. Tell me about yourself. I was born in Nihliesh, and my parents were good people. I learned the walkways of the second tier by heart. That's how I discovered the portal to the bloom. I kept seeing the traders who came back from here, and they always had such interesting wares. One day I snuck after them. I wanted to see where they came from. Her face darkens. That was the day that bloom closed its pathway to my home. I used to think it was my fault, but the bloom doesn't seem to care for me now. After I got here and discovered I couldn't get home, I had to find a way to survive. I found 5 families who were willing to help me, and who could afford to feed me once every few days.
I helped them when I could and kept looking for a way home. But as I got older... She looks embarrassed. I needed more excitement. That's when I met Vrung. She looks away, unwilling to say much more. She thinks, I should have known better, but I was so lonely. No, never again. It was my psychic power that drew him to me. He saw what I had. He wanted to take it, use it for himself. He called me an empathic amplifier. I could read people, and I could make their feelings stronger. He used me to find out who the scared people were, and then we preyed on them. I snuck through a portal in Nihliesh, but for the charity of families here, I might have died. I never felt like I fit in, not until I met Vrung. Those times, I'm not proud. How did you fall in with Vrung in the first place? He seemed dark and fascinating. The adults didn't want me to go near him, but he was like a mirror of what I wanted to be. Strong, mysterious, ambitious. I let him bend me and use my powers to make him more of what he wanted to be. And I didn't realize I was trapped until it was too late. He skulked through the dark places of the bloom, and I thought he was dangerous and alluring. He led me on and took me in, and I didn't realize what sort of person he was until it was far too late. Farewell. Fahat be with you. Okay, so Qianne. I found Delny and Vrung at the end of an alley in Little Nihliesh. Now I need to find a way to stop them from harassing Qianne. I've dealt with Delny and Vrung. I should return to Qianne and tell her what happened. Okay.
Fair enough.
Oh, we'll do that at some point. Looks like we can possibly get through here. The interior of the container, and then through to the other side to get to Memavira's courtyard again. Alright, so let's see if we can have an audience with this Gar-koto. This statue is identical to its nearby twin, except for the fact that its head has fallen off. That's the other one I read before. Hail, mutant guard! Spiny one. Spiniferous one. Say? Hands away from your weapons, human. You stand before its noble grace, Gar-koto. Keep your tongue civil, and you'll keep your tongue. Can I look at this tank, or just... I guess not. I'm just gonna speak somehow. Can you hear me in there? Gar-koto. You stand before a painted spherical tank, fashioned of metal and synth. The paint is old and cracking. Inside the tank is a murky liquid, or possibly a thickened gas, and every so often you can see motion from a fluke, flipper, or strangely deformed arm within. A cleverly disguised grill on the front of the tank squawks out the distorted voice of the tank's occupant. It buzzes and moans, drawing out some words and shortening others in a burst of static. I am Gar-koto, a prince of the Fahat and their delegate here at Little Nihliesh. The voice spits and pops. You have my gratitude for averting the violence with the Memavira's soldiers. But I must know, why did you act? Violence wouldn't have helped anyone, and it might have had greater repercussions. No gold. I guess if it was the right thing to do, I would have gotten gold. Gar-koto is silent for a moment. An admirable sentiment, human. One that appears to be more and more difficult to maintain given the recent troubles plaguing us. Violence is in the air. Change comes for us all. But the Memavira does not seem to grasp this truth. A wise and just action. Male and female, so I guess we use they. A wise and just action. But did she mean it this way? It's like an indigo and blue tide. Raise a small and tiny amount, respectively. The flux in the bloom, and the dust of Memavira's weakness. is apparent in the instability of the maws we use for trade and transport. The old maws are closing, and new ones open to take their place. There was a new maw here in Little Nihliesh, one I would like to see opened. But the Memravira refuses to aid me. She won't even lead her fortress. But I have said enough. What would you have for me? Just what was the proximate cause of the fight between the Memravira's guards and your people? Tide. The tank's grill spits a shower of sparks. The bloom no longer favors the Memravira. The bloom is the source of the Memravira's power. If she has no power, the obligation to pay for her protection is vanished. We pay for reality, not promises. The distorted voice crackles with an electric sigh. Perhaps our people have grown tired of the humans taking. Where did your people come from? Our home is the city of Nihliesh and the steadfast beyond. My cousins of the Fahat rule over the three-tiered city wisely and well. When a maw portal opened in Nihliesh, we investigated to see if we might eke out a profit. We saw enough possibility that our explorers sent for me, a minor prince of the Fahat. I was to head this trade embassy. The speaker makes a slightly embarrassed noise. I did not think that the maw would close behind us, but 10 years ago it did. Let me just read this again. I'm trying so hard to make the words shorter and longer. I'm not even paying attention. Like, I'm not even really. It's not penetrating my skull what I'm reading. Yep. Tell me of the steadfast. You ask much of me. I can only tell you what I've heard of our glorious city is in what they call the beyond. Steadfast is a collection of principles, kingdoms, principalities, and other lesser denominations of feudalism, held together by the dictates of their religion, the Order of Truth. The Aeon priests of the Order have spread their faith far and wide. I hear they've even established a foothold in the city of Sagus Cliffs. Oh, you just repeated the exact same thing back? Pretty much. Tell me more about Nihliesh. The speaker is silent for a moment. The city was once a machine, a colossal device that creates churn. We built atop the machine, creating elaborate structures and impossible architecture, and our city grew into the sky. The great and powerful of Nihliesh lives among the fluted spires and arcing byways, with powered cars lifting us to the skies in a moment. The shops and palaces of our people, alas, to think that I might die away from my home. The voice goes very quiet. Thanks to see sunrise over the cold desert again, to speak with Yixli on the concourse one last time. What can you tell me of the Fahat? My brethren are blessed mutants, each diverging into a new pathway for humanity. We rule over the city of Nihliesh, using the powers bestowed by our remarkable births to lead normal humanity to a new age of possibilities. We are close in spirit, yet rivals in politics, for the truth of a mutation lies in its ability to prove its use. The subtleties of our machinations are lost here, alas. Blessed mutants, each diverging into a new pathway for humanity, we rule over the city of Nihliesh, using the powers bestowed by our remarkable births to lead normal humanity to a new age of possibilities. Ask. Why are the maws changing and closing? Do you ask for my knowledge or my conjecture? If the first, and I must confess my ignorance. If the second, Gar-koto pauses, considering, and the grill hisses and sparks when the mutant speaks again. if the second, I believe the bloom has a feeding cycle. It is an enormous organism, you know, and I suggest that these events are part of a larger pattern. The mutant's vast bulk shifts in the tank. Perhaps the bloom is preparing itself for a new Memorvera. Hmm. I suggested that perhaps the bloom has entered a new part of its feeding cycle, and that it might be preparing itself for a new Memorvera. The speaker spits and hisses again, but I do not say this as a certainty. I only read and observe. Do you want to take the Memorvera's place? Gar-koto's laughter spits out in a staticky hiss. I do not desire such responsibility, nor do I seek the attentions of the bloom. Hmm. Just around the corner, there's a crashed vehicle. How did it get here? Ah, the Katana. A year ago, the clocks began to act strangely, speeding and slowing, pulsing. Then the air began to bulge in places. We thought nothing of it, considering our surroundings, and then space itself tore open, and this monstrosity tore through the Little Nihliesh. It pulverized the house of Antugar and Soyen, erasing their family. Since then, enterprising scavengers have sought wealth in their wreckage, but most avoid the Katana. It is haunted by the ghosts of its passage. It tore through time, space, and probability, destroying a good mutant family before penetrating the bloom's walls. Now its passengers' ghosts dwell inside. Best to steer clear of it. Why are you imprisoning Herja? She has committed a grievous crime, will remain in the prison of her mind until she confesses. The voice is colder than before. Herja knows the nature of her crime. Perhaps she will admit the truth to you. They think the deaths of my people are on her head. Her hands stink with their agony. You are certain she is guilty? I have examined the evidence. I have heard her words. I have declared her sentence. I am a prince of the Fahat, and I rule here. Yes, she is guilty. Does she not deserve the presumption of innocence? She may, but I have met her kind before. She will tell you of her innocence, and she will convince you of her rights. Yet she is sick, rotten at her core, and she requires correction. They think she may even consider herself innocent if she has lost all connection to humanity. She claims to be innocent. I have passed my judgment. I do not do so rashly without consideration for the facts. Speak to her. You will find certainty if you persist. They think, of course she does. All the knights have convinced themselves of their innocence. She is a known enemy of mutant kind. She need only confess her guilt and she will again see the clean air of the outside world.
I'll remember that.
As you turn, the speaker buzzes once more. Ah, in case word has not yet reached your ear, I am offering a bounty to the first who can open the newborn maw and tell me what lies on the other side. The voice pauses. Of course, the first step is to discover what the maw wishes to eat. Without that knowledge, it cannot be opened. Hmm. I'll look into it. Very well. Alright, let's talk to Herja again.
Why not?
Yeah, why not? You know, she's getting ready to attack us. She can't even, like, put her finger on us. Back again so soon? Her smile doesn't reach her eyes. Have you come to free poor Herja from her cage? Can you tell me why you were imprisoned again? Hmm. I maintain my innocence. I've done nothing wrong. I don't even like saying that deceiving way. I don't think you're telling me everything. The mutants must have some reason to be suspicious of you. You can only go to 55. However, Tiber are gonna go to 80. Alright, Tiber. Success. She studies you carefully, weighing your words against some internal barometer. At last she says, "Yes, it's true that I poisoned their water. I could not enter Nihliesh itself, but I had heard of this bastard offshoot of their clan. I wanted to slay one of the Fahat. I took the journey from the Steadfast under considerable peril, and I brought death with me." She thinks, "They are not human. They are not. Surely I did right by my people."
I'll remember that.
"This is the first time that I have tried something like this. I do not regret what I did. The mutant prince wishes to see me show remorse, but he will not have the satisfaction." "I told you already. I tried to poison the mutants here, to remove their taint from the world, but I failed. The old... a few of them died, the old and the sick, but most of them were only sickened for a time." Alright, return. Guilty! I say do as you will. "Speak. The Prince of the Fahat would hear your questions." "Why do you want to open the new maw?" "We are exiles here, far from our home in Nihliesh. It is..." Sparks fly from the grill. "Pardon, we hope that the maw will open again in our fair city. But if it doesn't, as seems likely, we stand to profit from a potential new trade route. Either way, we benefit." "We want to return home to Nihliesh. Barring that, we wish to profit from a new trade route." Speaker buzzes. "Of course we prefer the former." Herja admitted her crime to me. "I see. In truth, it was not a mere confirmation of her crime that I sought. I wanted her to face her victims and admit what she did. Only then would I know if she feels anything for them, if she's truly human or not." The voice chuckles. "A strange thing for a creature in a tank to be concerned with. Still, I thank you for telling me." I guess that's it. "May you achieve your goals this day." A new maw is open in Little Nihliesh. Gar-koto is offering a reward for the first person who opens the maw and tells him what lies on the other side. Find out what the newborn maw wants to eat. Every maw hungers for something in particular, and it will only open after it's been fed. If I want to open the newborn maw, I'll need to discover what it wants to eat. Delny, the young mutant woman who I freed from Vrung, is a psychic with strong empathic abilities. She might be able to sense what the maw wants. Oh, excellent. I know there's a reason I kept checking these things. So Delny's still here. Talk to her. I really don't want to offer my companions and make them, like, hate me just a little bit more. With the glamour removed from her, you can see Delny for who she truly is. A young mutant woman, slender, her light blue skin accentuated by her bright pink hair. Her features are still sharp, but she has a softness of youth about her. I read all this, right? She blinks, clearing her eyes. "What can I do for you?" "There's a new maw in Little Nihliesh. Can you use your mental powers to find out what it wants?" I could, I suppose, but I need to get near the maw to build a proper rapport with it. And I don't think that's a very good idea. I freed you from Vrung. This is all I ask in return. 90. She considers your words, weighing them carefully. At last she comes to a decision. "All right. You did help me when you didn't have to. I'll do it." "Be careful." Oh no. She steps up to the maw, and her hair seems to rustle. in an unseen wind. Delny glances back at you, eyes bright with fear. It wants me. Oh, no. Look at her bright blue sneaker, too. She's so cool. It wants me, she repeats, and she quakes as the moss tongue begins to stir and writhe. Lifting, questing, probing, they reach toward her, and she takes a step backward in fright. You know, I wouldn't be standing there saying it wants me, it wants me. I'd be freaking out of there. It wants me! The pitch of her voice is rising. Something is drawing it to me, and that part of me reaches back. Oh, that's nice. Her voice becomes more dreamy. Would it be so bad? Would it be so bad to be devoured? To give my voice to the bloom? To carry on through the years as... No, wait. Wait. Wait! The tongues withdraw as Delny reaches out to them. See, they seem to have lost interest in her altogether. Oh, I'm glad now. As her hand touches one, it snaps back, and she whimpers in despair. Then she shakes her head as if waking from a dream. What was I thinking? It was like hypnotizing you or something.
Making a note.
Now that she knows that the Maw no longer desires her, Delny is braver than she was, and she stands amidst the bloom tongues, her hand outstretched. Well, she was already standing amidst the bloom tongues. Her hair fans out around her head, a pink corona, a nimbus that seems to crackle with energies of its own. Guilt, she announces. It feeds on guilt. Oh, Tiber? Tiber has some guilt, I believe. She turns away from the Maw. It tasted the guilt I feel for what I did when I was Vrung's toy, but I knew I wasn't responsible for that, so my guilt wasn't strong enough. Someone who has genuine guilt, not regret, not shame, but all-consuming guilt, the Maw will devour them. She shivers. I think my debt to you is paid. I'm not sure if Tiber has all-consuming guilt. Maybe Vrung would feel guilty for what he did? It's loud. Any more info? She eyes the Maw warily. Don't get too close if you're feeling guilty, she warns. It hungers. Tell me again what you learned about the Maw. She shivers. It wants guilt. It wants people who feel their guilt strongly, who bathe in it, whose hearts are stones of remorse. It said would lay bare that guilt and then take it away. Really? That might be a good thing. If I have to be with you. Hail Maw? Am I guilty? A reddened mass of flesh protrudes from the bloom wall, surrounded by waving tendrils. The flesh is thick and strong, glistening like a newborn beast. A jagged seam runs across its surface, with faint light spilling from within. You got a codex for Maw. As you approach, all the sounds of Little Nihliesh seem to fade. The hushed conversations of the mutants recede into the distance, replaced by the hissing, chittering voices of the bloom. You realize suddenly that this is a Maw. You're not sure how you know, but the word leaps into your mind as if you've seen this thing before. Yeah, I've seen it before. This is like the third one I've found. Right? Actually, technically it's the fourth. If we count what's-his-name up there who has his maws in himself. The waving tendrils you know with equal certainty are its tongues. Observe the behavior of the bloom tongues. The fleshy tendrils probe the air as if they caught a faint scent of something they like. Their movements are quick and eager, giving an impression of youthful vigor, but they don't seem interested in you. The tendrils don't seem to notice you. They continue to sway and stretch, perhaps catching a faint scent of something that appeals to them. One of my compatriots? Listen carefully to the bloom's voices. The hissings and chittings of the bloom are no different than usual, as far as you can tell. Your sharp senses provide no particular advantage in hearing the odd sounds. You realize that the bloom's voices are a psychic phenomenon, not a physical one. They are literally voices in your head. You can't detect any patterns or meanings in the sound. They seem entirely random. The hissings and chittings of the bloom are no different than usual, as far as you can tell. Offer myself? It doesn't want me, though, right? You step closer to the waving tendrils. Though you're well within reach of the maw itself, the bloom tongues don't even twitch in your direction. They're obviously not interested in you at all. Anyone guilty?
War makes villains of us all. But what Herja did...
He thinks what we all did. Tiber spreads his hands, as if trying to hold something foul at bay. Like looking in a mirror, wasn't it? You feel guilty. That's low, he says, hurt and anger in his eyes. I've done things I regret, but if you think I'm anything like that, you're a damn poor judge of character. He shakes his head, angry. I would never, never... His eyes turn inward. I wouldn't, would I? Okay. Thought I could make him feel guilty. Aratus?
What's on your mind?
Castige? That's it. I wonder if Allegern feels guilty. Alright, let's return with our findings then. I need someone who's guilty. Who feels guilty anyway.